Okay, just want to welcome everybody to Sunday service. All of you on Zoom, whoever's on Facebook, just welcome and thank you for being here with us. Just want to say to all of you on Zoom and Facebook, please feel free to unmute, share a prayer, a word, a picture, or a praise report. Just as much as you can be part of it. If you can't hear, just let us know, message any one of us, or just unmute and say can't hear, because we just want you to be as much part of this and as much part of this worship service here today. Just want to say a very, very, very warm Highway Bangalore welcome to Melissa. So for those of you who don't know here, Melissa, in fact Meher is here as well online, are part of All Saints, the OG Highway, literally. I mean, we work together also and try. It's so wonderful. Melissa works with IJM, is doing International Justice Mission, doing amazing work. That's Melissa. That's Rini. So it's really lovely to have you here. Yeah. Next time you come here and lead worship with us. And there's Noel here, Noel Fredericks, who's Misha's cousin. All of us know Misha, who comes online. So Noel's moved to Bangalore, so wonderful to have you here as well. And this will be Akila's last Sunday with us. Maybe she'll join from London. And of course, we have another OG All Saints person here with us, Sagar. We have to get more people from Bombay, then Sagar will come. Yeah, otherwise, he lives 5 minutes from our house and doesn't come. Anyway, just thank you all for being here. And just as we just start, I just want to say, just let's just quiet our spirits, our minds. God is here. And we just want to honor him and worship him with all that we do this morning. So I want to start with Psalm 84. And I'm reading from the Passion Translation, so just a little different version. Psalm 84, entitled here, says, Longing for God. God of heaven's armies, you find so much beauty in your people. They're like lovely sanctuaries of your presence. Deep within me are these lovesick longings, desires and daydreams of living in union with you. When I'm near you, my heart and my soul will sing and worship with my joyful songs of you, my true source and spring of life. O Lord of heaven's armies, my King and my God, even the sparrows and swallows are welcome to build a nest among your altars to raise their young. What pleasure fills those who live every day in your temple, enjoying you as they worship in your presence. And there's a little word here, normally we see in the Psalms, which says Selah, but here they've translated it as pause in his presence. So we just pause a bit and then I'll continue reading. How enriched are they who find their strength in the Lord. Within their hearts are the highways of holiness. Even when their paths wind through the dark valley of tears, they dig deep to find a pleasant pool where others find only pain. He gives to them a brook of blessing filled from the rain of an outpouring. They grow stronger and stronger with every step forward. And the God of all gods will appear before them in Zion. Hear my cry, O God of heaven's armies, God of Jacob, listen to my loving prayer. And it says, pause in his presence. God, your wraparound presence in our defense, in your kindness, look upon the faces of your anointed ones. For just one day of intimacy with you is like 1,000 days of joy rolled into one. I'd rather stand at the threshold in front of the gate beautiful, ready to go in and worship my God, than to live my life without you in the most beautiful palace of the wicked. For the Lord God is brighter than the brilliance of a sunrise, wrapping himself around me like a shield. He is so generous with his gifts of grace and glory. Those who walk along his paths with integrity will never lack one thing they need, for he provides it all. O Lord of heaven's armies, What euphoria fills those who forever trust in you. Amen.
Overwhelmed by the way.
maybe a few of us can just speak out and tell the world of the treasure that we found. Just thank you, Jesus, Lord, that you have been my life, my deliverer, my rescuer. You have truly lifted me up, Lord, from the pits and placed my feet on solid ground. There's no treasure more precious than you, Lord. Just want to say that and declare that. In your precious name, just thank you and pray. Amen.
Let your glory fill this house. Pour it out. Yourself to us in a greater measure. Fill this house, fill every house, Lord, where people are praising you and worshipping you, Lord, to overflowing with your Holy Spirit. We invite you, Lord, today, come and fill us with a deeper measure, so that we can overflow to do your work for your kingdom. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
This next one is a friend of God, and I thought I would also. It's okay. I'd like to share something which during this week I've felt I had a bit of a vision like this. So, how many of you have been to Thailand? Travel and this thing. And there's this one particular section in the market where I'm remembering back in 85, 86 when I went with my mom and dad. Sandhya wasn't born yet, but there was this. I remember there was this kind of like this, one side of the market where, you go on the boats and there are these vendors that are just passing by. And I had this, it is like this kind of vision where, I'm basically in this tourist boat, okay, and me with somebody, and that somebody, it has to be, it is God. And he's just making me kind of go through this part. I'm seeing other boats, and these other boats, I'm actually saying it's guys like you, it's people like you. And I was always kind of reminding myself, each of you have your vessels, right? And we say that we are vessels of God, and the thing is, when I kind of introspect and look further beyond that, I realize that each of you, while I'm looking, it's like I said, you guys are vendors, right? And I'm basically looking at your vessels to see what you've got. There's something good I'm getting from you. But at the same time, I see a lot of you have, including myself, there are some scars, there are some cuts, some deep, some this thing. And it's just like God is like looking at me and he's still, don't worry. These are vessels you can trust, and these are this is just like you, and they are also looking at your vessels, what you've got, and I felt like I wanted to share that. It's just that I think with each of us, whatever we're bringing on, and I feel God leads us through each of our, through our lives, through our testimonies, and it's just something that I felt that it's that one way of getting closer to God, and I get to experience that closeness of God and that friendship of God through you guys. So let's try this. This might be a new song.
this?
I think
that's all I'm
Who am I that you are mindful of me? That you hear me when I call? Is it true that you are thinking of me? How you love me? It's amazing. Who am I that you are mindful of me? That you
us to partner with you. this isn't a relationship where we just blindly listen to everything, but you're truly calling us into a partnership where you really care about our heart's desires, our needs, our wants. And we thank you, Jesus. Thank you for treating us with so much love, so much respect, so much care. Thank you, Jesus, that we have the privilege to be called your friend. Just like all the greats in the Bible, we're called friend just like you call Abraham your friend. We're grateful to you for that, Lord.
Thank you, Uday, Sandy and Rini. That was just beautiful. And we're very blessed because they're going to come back and do closing worship as well. I just thought that even as we sang this song, and Uday gave us, that was such a beautiful picture of us together. So I just thought it would be nice for us to do praise reports at this point, because praise reports also are a way in which we encourage each other and strengthen each other. As well as give glory, and most importantly, give glory to God. So we do praise reports, and I'm going to encourage even those on Facebook, please feel free to share a praise report. I'll turn it around so you can also be
bubbling with this, because I was hoping what we'll get into next would be praise reports.
Praise
because
God.
Really the picture was, you know, that we're like, thank you there for that, because that we're sailing also on the river of life, like our boats are in the river of life almost. And so my report is that I've always had a heart for my workplace in general, but not so much just evangelizing at the workplace, but I always see like the talent that we have at church. I'm like, everything that we experience here, I just want it infused into the workplace, and like that's the, like, I feel that's the solution to have great culture in the workplace, you know, that like what we carry to be moved in there. And so it used to be there in my previous organizations, but at this company it took quite a while. But really, just two praise reports. One is that we recently did like the morale and the tech team has been really low, and they had done this pulse survey to figure out like what are the issues and all of that. And the only name that was mentioned in the qualitative feedback was, whatever, they have many issues, but they're like, we really enjoy the fun activities that Rahel conducted. Rahel has not conducted any. Yeah. Rahel has just stolen Nestin and brought and that's truly it, right? I'm getting the praise for it, but truly all I've done is like taken him there. And so they don't know, to him, to them, he's a resource person that I have brought, right? But yeah, so firstly is that, like the gift in his vessel that I can carry into my workplace. And the second thing is, I just got back from a 2-day leadership workshop. And so this is what we call the quarterly business review. And this is our core leadership team, and they've had 8 so far, of course, over the last few years. And at the end of it, everybody feels like depleted and broken and down. And my boss asked me, like, before we left, so this is the first time that my boss and I had to do it. And I was like super nervous, because I've always been really intimidated by this leadership team. And then she was like, okay, I asked her what she wanted from the end of these 2 days, and she told me, and immediately this like idea came. But then just before the event, I called Pervin, we prayed, and she just gave me 2-3 very simple ideas to kind of bring into the event. And what we started the event and what we ended the event with, which were some of the ideas that she shared with me, were literally like, you know, tied the ribbon, and everyone left QBR feeling full and happy and united and connected, instead of feeling broken. And the words that used to be in the past were like power play and politics and this, that. And the end of this, everyone, it's like 36 people there, and everyone was like, this was so amazing, I'm so glad, we're gonna do this together, guys, one team. And they were like fist pumping each other, and I was like, what's going on here? And really, I got so much recognition for it, but truly it was those simple kutti kutti things that Pervin offered to me that I could take into the meeting. So thank you, Jesus, for this body and for what's happening here.
The floor, and also Facebook. And so actually there are some more new people who've joined us this morning, and I really, it's to Suvish, please introduce your mom to us.
Yes. I'm Suvish mom, and I saw this song here, Good Good Father,
I thought you'd be singing the song, but then you sang
before. No, no, it's coming in the second set.
No, I go to the traditional church where they sing only hymns and all that, so I'm not very sure of this song. But after listening to my son singing it every time, I thought he wrote this song. He has written a few songs.
Yes, we've heard him here.
This song, whenever I hear, no, I feel so nice and good and thank God for all his goodness. My testimony, if I could share, it's in a short.
Yes, please.
Yeah. I'm a cancer survivor. 7 years back, I had breast cancer and the right breast was removed. But it's all God's goodness that I'm here today. When we think of everything was taken care, though the disease was there with me, I was treated, people were around me, God was there throughout, but I could see Jesus standing far away. He could see my pain, but he was there with me. The finance was taken care of, people there to take care of me. I lost my hair, I lost my eyebrows, but God gave everything back. But there are few who did not survive, they had the same situation, but God made me fine and well, and here I am testifying.
Yes, and we have Sunny. That's Sunny in the hat. a friend of Ritu's.
Yes.
Hi. Hello, everybody. Good morning. Happy to be here. My name is Sunny. Long-time friend of Ritu Aunty. Ritu Aunty and my mother are also very long-time friends.
Yeah.
And as Ritu pointed out, we were in Coram Deo. And now we're here. I'm looking forward to being a part of this community and joining the praise, joining the fellowship, joining the worship. I'm happy to be here. Thank you.
welcome.
Yes. Oh my gosh.
What? You know each other?
Yeah.
Oh dear.
Sunday knows everything.
Sunday's a new
COVID.
Yeah. Yes, thank you.
See, exactly new
COVID. I was on my way up from ID and he
hit. Oh, how nice.
And I joined the same role that
This is crazy. Okay. Yes, praise reports. Joni.
The past couple of weeks have been difficult. I was actually having a conversation with Rachel yesterday and she was like, what's going on in your head? Like, what are the different questions you're having? I'm sorry if I'm speaking very softly. Well, right now, through this time, I'm going to get baptized next week. I'm just eternally grateful for this community and for just different, I wouldn't say role models, but different ideas of healthy love which I can see around. Different ideas of friendship, of romantic love. And it really is healing the warped ideas in my head which I carry. I'm very grateful that God has called me to get baptized, to sing, and I'm not always doing the right thing, but that's okay. Yeah, that's okay. And I'm very grateful for it.
Yes. Okay, there's a praise report from Vinay. He says, finished a couple of weeks of worship guitar lessons, sessions. That includes me and Rini, I think. Yeah. We're also part of his students. Two of my students are there at service right now. Yes. But it's just been crazy how God put it all together so quickly and how each person has their own unique journey and we're able to explore and grow and worship together. It's so nice after Rahil's, just the resources in the fellowship and how we're supporting each other. Wonderful. Thank you, Vinay.
That same analogy of the boat, I think I got such a beautiful opportunity through Suvish to go to St. Joseph's and teach, and it was supposed to be one session with fifth graders on a Monday, and I was all set for that. Rest of the week I'm going to do my personal sessions. I work as a psychologist, so it was just I prepared for that, and then after that a couple of teachers came in and said, hey, would you be able to come again on Wednesday to teach to do a session for grade 7 and 8. And I said, okay, sure. I said, okay, well, in that case, can you also come on Friday? I was like, So it was just so incredible that in the last 1 week, I got to meet over 1,000 children.
Whoa!
I got to speak about God. And these are all non-Christians, by the way, because the retreat is for the Catholics and the non-Catholics, and the majority of the non-Christians was who I was speaking with. And I got to speak about God and prayer and just about, you know, how your mind is, about so many things about the mind. And it was incredible. And I didn't realize that I would love it so much. Like, I usually have stage fright, but I felt like, you know, like it was just my space.
She killed it. Yes.
I have a press report. So, very grateful for finally getting my results. And so happy to have Mel a part of this journey. And very grateful for Sajina as well. And they've really been there. The last 2 semesters especially, Mel constantly like, Stace, what's the update? How much have you finished studying? And I really needed that. And even though she wouldn't study, she'd make sure I study. And then I asked her, she would be like, oh, this is done. And then we really pushed each other through. Really grateful to God for her and for everything through this course. Pray for her.
Distinction.
I completed 1 year at work.
That was Sandeep at the back for anybody on Facebook and Zoom. Yes.
Okay. My praise report is not going to be as short as Sandeep's. But a couple of things happened at work. First of all, I was able to share something about God in some small way with my kids. The weird thing is, out of all the classes I teach, the number of Christian students in all of them is one. I have one Christian student. But something came up about Solomon, and I started telling them about the stories of Solomon and explaining that in Christianity there's only one God. And so I went full evangelistic. God gave me that opportunity. In another class, we were doing Malgudi days, and somebody is asking me, but why did Jesus die? The student asks me this. And it was just the way God created opportunities for me to just share the gospel, you know, in ways that I didn't think was possible. So really thanking God for that. So that's number one. Number two is just thanking God for favor in my workplace. There was some technical problem with the punching out thing, and all the teachers have just gotten their salary, like half day cut, that's it. And I requested my principal kept thing, and she said, I will take care of it. I will say that you were on duty or something and sanction my leave. And I've been here for a month and a half. And to find that favor when teachers with so much experience are just getting their salary cut. The second part of favor is, apart from training this debate team and going with them for a national level competition, sometime next week I'm going as a judge sent by my school for an English festival. This is my first job. I have taught for all of 1.5 months in my entire life. Just thanking God for his favor.
I have a report, it will be short.
Wait. Let them see you.
Just to say that, yeah, we've been married for 6 months.
No!
You heard her praise report. And there's the tourism is happy wife, happy life. Yeah.
Your mother-in-law is on Facebook, by the way. Perfect timing. So I just have a praise report, which is I want to thank God for Akila, because yes, kitna she's gonna hide me. Because she has just been, you know, I last year when mom had the stress fracture in December, Akila was gonna leave by the 19th of January, and we had discovered all of this around the first week of January, and I didn't know how I was going to manage. And she stayed back
and ended up staying back till March. So she spent 3 months here, and literally she worked from, her work would start at some 12 o'clock in the afternoon, I think, and go on till 10 o'clock at night. And in the morning, she would be there taking care of mom. When she came even for mom's funeral, she stayed back and spent another 2 weeks here. And this time as well, spent a month here. And I cannot even begin to say what that has meant for me, just to have her here, to know that she's here through it all, helping me. Yesterday we worked till about 12 o'clock at night trying to sort through some of mom's stuff, and that was difficult, but just having her there was a really, so she's going back, so I just want to say thank you, God, for her.
I'm a short one.
Loudly. Loudly.
Okay. I didn't share last week because I think I was still kind of processing, but basically, you know, Appa's ashes, he asked to have it put in different places, right? So my aunt and uncle were at the crematorium, and he was being flippant when he suggested that he wanted to be put some of my ashes in Muscat, put some of my ashes with Amma and Coimbatore, take it to Sweden if you can one day. And so these were all, it's like, okay, so I guess we're just going to hold on to the ashes and just doing, I don't know. So my aunt and auntie came and she's like, oh my God, Molly, you know, we're going to Europe and we're doing this trip and we're going to Sweden. And we said, oh well, let's see what's happening first then. And so we sent some of the ashes with them, and then Friday, the week before, Friday is when they interred the ashes at a really beautiful place. There's like little, there's this beautiful lake and there's a museum, and they've taken a video of, you know, how to, and even that, how that came about was quite, Udi and I were waiting the whole day because they said we'll video call you and you can, you know, you can be part of it. And Udi decided, you know, I'm just going to step out for 5 minutes at 5 o'clock in the evening, you know, I'm just going to step, I just need to buy some stuff. And the second he stepped out is when they called. And I was thinking, I can't do this without Uday. And so I just said, I'll just say a prayer. And they said, we'll record it. So then I thought, you know, that's actually beautiful because that way we'll actually get to keep it and I'll actually know when it's perfect. So that was really nice. So just grateful to God for making that happen. It was the wildest thing to happen, but it's happened. And the other thing is, you know, we were wondering what to do about the ashes here in Bangalore also. I'm just trying to think of just an appropriate place. And this Saturday, Friday, we Saturday. Were just talking to our neighbor, and you know, she's like, why don't you just put them in? And they have this in front of our house where we've been the longest actually. There's this beautiful, like, fruit and veggie garden that they have. And they said, we'll just put them there. Really grateful for that.
I want to thank God for showing up just like we were praying and we were worshipping. I think I still remember Ryan singing Prepare the Way of the Lord. And I was picturing Christ just dancing and walking into the places, workplaces, I mean, school, Ryan's work, right? Your school, and just Jesus showing up, just dancing with all his glory. And it's amazing that he wants to just show up with us and be and use each one of us. So praise God for that. Also, I was thinking about Stonehill quite a bit when I joined, because I declined the offer. And I was like, this is a good decision. I was confused the first month because our ground is being constructed. There's no ground. The kids are irritated, frustrated. They can't play. And I was like, should I have gone there? I think I would save more souls there. I'm missing out on so much of a pay. But praise God, I think at the end of the month, I got a hike. And for some reason, and I think the celebration is as much as Stonehill, but not Joseph's, but all of us. Thank you, God, for that.
I'm praising God that after 3 years, we finally had our Little More Love Fellowship gathering, thanks to Rini's organization skills. Yay. It was a very sweet time, so really grateful for that.
Anybody else? Otherwise we can, Prema will take us through the word. So Prema is going to take us, we're going to continue. So for those who've just come in here today for the first time, what we've been doing as a church. So Highway is a church that's in, well, started out of Bombay and now has a fellowship in Pune and Bangalore. And of course, people join us from different cities, sometimes different countries, online. What we started in June actually was, the past people who pastor our church, Uday and Anila, they're based in Bombay. They lead highway across the country. So God laid on Uday's heart to go deeper into Acts, into Book of Acts, and literally to go into the Book of Acts. So what we've been doing as a church every Sunday has been actually going through the book, and different people, Uday kind of creates the outline, and then each different people in different cities bring the word to us. So we're doing that every Sunday, and every Tuesday he's taking us through online, he's taking us through Revelations. So that's what's been happening. So Prema is going to continue, I think, with Acts 3, am I right?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay guys, we're starting. So I'm just going to start with a prayer.
Abba Father, we just want to thank you so much, Lord, that we get to come together. And we just get to just have a revelation of who you are, soak in your word, and really come and testify of all that you've done over the last week and over our lives, Lord. Thank you that we have this home and you are dwelling here. And we just surrender the next couple of minutes into your hands and pray, Lord, that you will speak to each one of us, Lord, uniquely and specially. That you will deposit something in our hearts that will challenge us, convict us, stir us, and encourage us, Lord. That truly, as we continue to dive into the early church's ways, we will be able to model your heart and we will be propelled into action, Lord. We pray that through this time you will speak, pray that you will anoint my tongue, that this will be all about you and you will get all the glory, honor, and praise. And you will stir us up to be your people in every single way, Lord. Be blessed, Lord Jesus, we pray. Amen. Okay, just like Pavan said, we've been going through the Acts and the early church over the last few weeks. We've had Melissa share, Nesson share, and the last time when Nesson shared, he spoke about the first church. Just to give a small recap before we move into today's passage, the early church, what Nesson shared was, they're so devoted to teaching, they were devoted to fellowship and to one another and prayer. They also ate a lot of toast together, they broke bread together, and they were really devoted in making sure everyone was helping one another. So they would sell their possessions in the hope that they could lift one another through whatever monetary returns they would get. And they were so thankful. They had such a posture of gratitude. They were always saying thanks to God. And people really, really liked them. It wasn't a thing of, will they be invited? It was when they will be invited. And Lord loved their posture and continued to multiply them. And that was the first church. And through the church, we saw many wonders and signs occur. And we will be now moving to Acts chapter 3. And I'll read the chapter before we move into breaking it down a little bit. It's a long passage, so if it's possible, do have the Bible with you so that you all can read along. So maybe on mute with Zoom, but in your mind. Acts chapter 3. One day Peter and John were going up to the temple at the time of prayer at 3 in the afternoon. Now a man who was lame from birth was being carried to the temple gate called Beautiful, where he was put every day to beg from those going into the temple courts. When he saw Peter and John about to enter, he asked them for money. Peter looked straight at him, as did John. Then Peter said, "Look at us." So the man gave them his attention, expecting to get something from them. Then Peter said, "Silver or gold I do not have, but what I do have I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk." Taking him by the right hand, he helped him up, and instantly the man's feet and ankles became strong. He jumped to his feet and began to walk. Then he went with them into the temple courts, walking and jumping and praising God. When all the people saw him walking and praising God, they recognized him as the same man who used to sit begging at the temple gate called Beautiful. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened to him. While the men held on to Peter and John, all the people were astonished and came running to them in the place called Solomon's Colonnade. When Peter saw this, he said to them, "Fellow Israelites, why does this surprise you? Why do you stare at us as if by our own prayer or godliness we have made this man walk? The God of Abraham, Isaac and Jacob, the God of our fathers, has glorified his servant Jesus. You handed him over to be killed and you disowned him before Pilate, though he had decided to let him go. You disowned the holy and righteous one and asked that a murderer be released to you. You killed the author of life, but God raised him from the dead. We are witnesses of this. By faith in the name of Jesus, this man whom you see and know was made strong. It is Jesus' name and the faith that comes through him that has completely healed him, as you can all see. Now, fellow Israelites, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did your leaders. But this is how God fulfilled what he had foretold through all the prophets, saying that his Messiah would suffer. Repent then and turn to God, so that your sins may be wiped out, that times of refreshing may come from the Lord, and that he may send the Messiah, who has been appointed for you, even Jesus. Heaven must receive him until the time comes for God to restore everything, as he promised long ago through his holy prophets. For Moses said, 'The Lord your God will raise him up for you, a prophet like me, from among your own people. You must listen to everything he tells you. Anyone who does not listen to him will be completely cut off from their people.' Indeed, beginning with Samuel, all the prophets who have spoken have foretold these days. And you are heirs of the prophets and of the covenant God made with your fathers. He said to Abraham, 'Through your offspring, all peoples on earth will be blessed.' When God raised up his servant, he sent him first to you to bless you by turning each of you from your wicked ways." And we'll just be reading chapter 4, 1 to 3. "The priest and the captain of the temple guard and the Sadducees came up to Peter and John while they were speaking to the people. They were greatly disturbed because the apostles were teaching the people, proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection of the dead. They seized Peter and John, and because it was evening, they put him in jail until the next day. But many who heard the message believed. So the number of men who believed grew to be about 5,000. So that's our passage for today. And it's a long one, it's a heavy one. And we will just be covering what spoke and what we would like to speak to us in this time, especially regarding what Jesus has told Peter and John and what Peter and John does. So when we deep dive, the first sentence in Acts 3 is, "One day Peter and John were going up to the temple at the time of prayer at 3 in the afternoon." This was Peter and John going about their daily practice of going to the temple to pray in the afternoon. They were practicing a habit they've had for a while of going to pray at this appointed time. And they were just going about their daily routine. And their routine included time with God. They were doing nothing out of the ordinary from their daily rhythm, but through that, extraordinary occurred. And we've seen that in the passage. And we see in this context of routine, revival break out. People multiply, people grow, people being awestruck. So how many of us can say we have cultivated a practice, a daily rhythm of following Jesus and becoming like him? 2 weeks back, Ness and Mera do an exercise of where we are at with the early church, what they do and what are we doing individually and corporately. And today it's for us to reflect on, more so individually, on how we practice the way of Jesus. And all of us know we can listen to others, we can listen to sermons, we can listen to podcasts, we can read, but we really need to act on our own. And it falls for anything. If you want to learn piano and you want to perform for a concert, if you haven't been practicing at the concert, everyone will know that you haven't been practicing. It could work for getting fit. If you want to get fit, you need to be practicing habits so that people will know that you're getting fitter and stronger. And we really can't be followers of Christ without practicing his way. And that's only through developing a routine where we are with him and become more like him. It really takes training, not just trying. And so today a lot of the focus is on holy habits, spiritual disciplines, or however you want to call it, some spiritual practices, whichever term that you use, they aren't, and spiritual habits, holy habits, aren't meant to make yourself right with God. You're already right with God. God has done it all for you, but it's to be with God and become the person we aim to be. Through prayer, worship, Bible reading, study, fasting, fellowship, giving, and outreach. Some of the spiritual practices that we are called to follow, we can gear up to become the people of God that He needs us to be in this age to come, where we are co-ruling, where we are co-partnering with Christ. And so the habits are not the goal, it's the means to an end. The habits are means of grace. And these habits, these spiritual disciplines, these practices, they are really what opens us up to the grace and empowering of the Holy Spirit to transform us into the people of love, into the people of power that really displays His glory. One of the first talks we watched on the Wednesday gatherings was this was the talk by this man called Jason Diba. And one of the statements that he said has really struck with me since the beginning of watching that video, which was, the grace of God empowers you to make daily healthy changes to your life. And so I'm changing it a bit to, the grace of God empowers you to make daily healthy changes to your life and routine. And we need to remember that grace is not opposed to effort, but to earning. We don't have to earn and strive for grace, and that's an attitude. But we do need to put effort, and grace is not opposed to effort, but thrives in it. And we will see that as we continue to read and dig deep in this passage. Peter and John, and even the early church's routine, was time with God daily. They spent time together with God, they spent time together with one another, and they were committed to it faithfully, and through that they were very sensitive to the Holy Spirit's leading. Their habits, and however you call them, made them so sensitive and made them discern the Spirit and enable them to exercise the power of God. God is asking us, you and I, to step into a daily rhythm with Him. And it's really not how much we can talk about God to a room of people. It's not about how we can make ourselves look super holy to the outside world. The beauty of Jesus and authentic faith is rooted in an intimate relationship, and that intimate relationship can only be cultivated through having a routine of these spiritual disciplines. And we see that displayed time and time again in the early church. And through their routine, when Peter and John were just going about their day, they came across a need. And it says, now a crippled man from birth was being carried to the temple gate called Beautiful, where he was put every day to beg from those going into the temple of courts. Peter and John didn't have to go looking for the need, looking to who they need to minister to. It was right there in their circumstance. It was in their environment. And what they were open. They were open to the opportunity, and they were open to God's leading. This man could have been there for a very long time. There's a good chance, some scholars say, that even during Jesus' time, this man would have been there. But God chose this appointed time to use Peter and John to be able to exercise the healing power. And what the lame man wanted was support. He wanted the arms to continue on in his way of life. But what Peter and John could do was completely change his entire life through the power of Jesus. And so as you cultivate a routine of spending time with God and being more like Him, you are really sensitive to the Spirit's prompting. And it leads you not only to understand His voice, but exercise His power. And you can see Peter and John being so obedient to that opportunity. They didn't shy away from it. They were available for that holy interruption. They wanted to go about their routine, but they were sensitive to what the Spirit was prompting them to do. And they readily moved to action. And so for you and I, where is the need? It's right here in this world. This is a world that so desperately needs light, and we get the chance to be that for other people. Interacting with them, meeting them where they are at, humanizing them, helping them, serving them, all these daily tasks will either point people towards Jesus or steer them away. And we really need to be mindful that if God uses other people to get to you, He's also using you to get to other people. Just like Melissa shared today, just in an environment, in your workplace, in your colleges, God is using you to get to other people. And so many times you are people's first or second exposure to life, to what life with Jesus would look like. And so we really need to be aligned with God's heart for people. Peter and John were so sensitive in knowing God's heart for this lame person that minute. And what did Peter do seeing that need? He exercised faith. Peter looked straight at him, as did John. And Peter said to the lame man, "Look at us." And they were so sensitive and they discerned the Spirit's prompting. I was just talking to Nesson and I said, the last thing I do when I meet a person that I need to pray for is say, "Look at me." If I were to do anything, I'd close my eyes. I'll be very timid in my reaching out to praying for anybody. But here you can see Peter in his boldness, in his exercising of a faith that God is going to do something. He was able to command and say, "Look at us." And I really love this verse because it really shows that faith leads to action. And I very much fall for the action bit. It's not enough to talk about the love of Jesus or how He's impacted our lives. Jesus beckons us to own our own faith. And He wants us to be confident in His plan, His prompting, His nudging, not our own. And you can see Peter display that when he boldly takes that man's hand and lifts him to his feet. He had supernatural trust in God, knowing that God was going to show up and God was going to do something. Can we say that we exercise that faith that leads to action? And the next thing Peter says to the lame man is, "Silver or gold I do not have, but what I have I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk." When's the last time we've used the name of Jesus to command someone to be healed, to declare healing, to declare restoration? And what the lame man asked for and wanted was not what Peter and John gave. They gave what he needed. And a little diversion, there's a story for those who come on Wednesdays would have heard, there's a humble monk walking with a Roman Catholic cardinal. And at a time in the Middle Ages where the Roman Catholic Church was at the zenith of its power, prestige and wealth, they had it all. The cardinal pointed to the opulent surroundings and said to the monk, "We no longer have to say, 'Silver and gold I do not have.'" But the monk replied, "But neither can you say, 'In the name of Jesus Christ, rise up and walk.'" Mm. And we are looking and in a time where it's a reminder that we have a God who will give us abundantly more than we can ever ask for. And He never provides us an outcome that is mediocre. But we need to step in and use the resources that we have. And those resources are, we have His word, we have His example, we have His ways, we have all that we need to bless the world around us. And He has plans for better and greater. So what is stopping us? And after you see Peter and John use up what they have and exercise the faith, you get to see the lame man's response. He jumped to his feet and began to walk. Then he went with them to the temple courts, walking and jumping and praising God. When all the people saw him walking, they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened to him. The lame man was transformed. And you can see the people around filled with wonder, filled with amazement, filled with astonishment. The works of an awesome God are awe-inspiring. They are one that leaves you feeling astonished, incredible, and make you feel filled with awe and wonder. And you get to see the posture of the lame man as well here. After a radical move of God, it propelled him to practice, not to preach. It propelled him to practice worship, practice thanksgiving, and it led others to see him and also respond with awe and wonder. If the works of God are awe-inspiring, are we seeing the words of God happen right now through our action, through our faith, and through our response? And the first thing Peter and John do, as soon as the lame man starts praising God, and as soon as the other people look at and get amazed by Peter and John, is Peter saw it and said to them, "Men of Israel, why does this surprise you? Why do you stare at us as if by our own power or godliness we have made this man walk? The God of Abraham, Isaac and Jacob, the God of our fathers, has glorified his servant Jesus." Peter didn't perform the miracle in order to preach, but he found the circumstances that through the miracle he was able to preach and speak the message of the gospel. And it was completely through a response of the people's reaction. So he saw an opportunity, he seized it. He was also so sensitive to what God was up to in that time. And there are three main elements of the message that Peter shares. He gives all the glory to Jesus, he witnesses about Jesus, and he turns people to Jesus. So we are stepped into bold confidence and faith, no matter what our anxiety and fear is telling us, and really trust that God will meet us there. If there's any lack, he will fill the spaces. So our eyes need to be on God and whatever we can do to give him the glory, rather than keeping our eyes on people. Because when it comes to people, we will end up wanting more. We will crave more attention. We will crave more affirmation. And that's the exact opposite posture of Peter and John. They don't want any credit. Even the credit of exercising the faith that Peter displayed, he gives all the credit to God alone. And his only message is turn back to Christ. And of course, this resulted in Peter and John getting seized because they offended people. It led to people putting them in custody. So when you read that message passage, you've seen that they get into custody for a day. But the ending of that line is, many who heard the message believed. So it never ends with, you think about the mountaintop, you think about they've exercised faith, but there you go. There's persecution at the end of it. There is offense there. There is keeping people unhappy and people are terribly angry, and there's, in this case, taken into jail. What would that look like for us? We don't know. But you can see the fruit of exercising the power, the fruit of exercising love, the fruit of the action. 5,000 men were added to their numbers, and the church continued to grow. In Acts 2, we saw 3,000 people come in, and through one message from Peter, through the display of faith and action of Peter and John, another 5,000 have been added, more than 5,000. You see the fruit that results in your actions, in your daily habits that is cultivated, that leads you to actions. And so all throughout the scripture, all throughout Acts, you see God partnering with people. It's not in solo. He wants to partner with you and with me. But to partner with him, we really need to cultivate a rhythm of practicing his way. You can't know God without having a mind of Christ, without really knowing his habits, without knowing his ways. So what would change about our lives today if we forged a partnership with God in all things? If we stop trying to carry the loads by ourselves and trying to change, if we eliminated all distractions and things that are consuming us and started back with developing a holy routine, a holy rhythm with him, trusting that he would shoulder the big and mighty things, that he would exercise the power, that he would nudge us, he would prompt us to action. So it's really not on you to do it all, not even a little bit. It's you to release that grip of fear, inadequacy, anxiety, and asking God to step in and partner with you. And you will see fruit. You will see fruit like Peter and John saw, like the early church saw, like every person in the scripture has seen. Because God works through you, God works in you, and God works with you. And if habits, if a routine, if cultivating that is your golden thread of communication with God, why wouldn't you invest in it? Why wouldn't you invest in worship, prayer, Bible study, fasting, fellowship, giving, outreach? Because as your rhythms and routine is developed, your faith thickens and your understanding of God and His ways expands. Today isn't a story, it isn't a learning of it happened then. This is truly a story of how can it happen now and what are we doing about it. So we'll just take the last few minutes to write down these seven habits and just ask yourself, where are you doing okay in these habits and where do you need to establish a routine with these habits? Before we do that, I'll just close us in prayer and then we can move into a reflection time. Yeah. Abba Father, we just want to continue to invite you here and we say sorry, Lord, for every way in which we have neglected walking with you and becoming more like you. Lord, you've given us a blueprint and we pray that through this time as we continue to dig into what the early church did and what the apostles did, Lord, enable us to have a posture that is open to receive you and to act, Lord. We want to be doers of your word. We also want to cultivate a habit that is holy, that is hard, that is so much behind the scenes, but truly bears such great fruit for your kingdom. So help us, Lord. We pray that through this time you will speak to us. You will reveal to us how we need to walk with you and follow you. And you will enable us to train to be better followers, Lord Jesus, for your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So just write down the disciplines: prayer, worship, Bible reading or study, fasting, fellowship, giving, and outreach. And ask ourselves right now, where are we doing okay? Where do you need to establish a routine? Prayer, worship, Bible reading or study, fasting, fellowship, giving, outreach. Where are you doing okay? Where do you need to establish a routine? Yeah, and maybe we can end with, if you've written it down, just find a pair next to you, someone next to you, and just pray for which one you're cultivating a routine for. Just ask the other person to pray for you. It can be one, all, anything. So just pray in prayers and we close it.
So
Prema spoke of holy habits, and communion is one such holy habit where we get to remind ourselves about what Jesus did for us. I just felt like reading something that Prema said. The holy habits or the spiritual practices aren't meant to make yourself right with God. We already are because of what we're going to remind ourselves of right now. But it is to be with God and become the person we ache to be. And so I'm going to read what Paul reminded us about what Jesus did. So the Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." And proclaiming the Lord's death is proclaiming the resurrection power that we have in us, that we carry into the world. And so I just want to read a verse from the song we just sang. "As Jesus rose, so I shall rise. In ransom glory at the throne, my heart restored with all your saints I sing. Father, not my will but yours be done." So we just take this moment, Lord Jesus, to bring to light all that we want to surrender right now, lay at your feet, leave behind. Our sin, our guilt, any fear, inadequacy, anything, Lord. We just lay it down right now. Believing that because of what you have done on the cross for us, we are right with you, God. And we receive your Holy Spirit, your resurrection power, your grace to move into these holy rhythms and holy habits so that you may be glorified in and through our lives, Jesus. We ask this in your name. Amen.
That's a B. That's okay.
That's okay.
Sorry.
Ignore it.
Yeah.
Where is it?
No.
It's just very fast.
I feel like this House of Miracles, this is a declaration today. So really if you feel more to stand, to just like Prema preached today, to action, you know, what we know and feel. Let's start that today in worship.
So just wanted to just share about House of Miracles. I think what Sandy's saying is, I think obviously what God wants to do, because Pavni felt the song. Pavni is in Pune, our fellowship in Pune. And yesterday she sent, day before yesterday, she sent a message saying she felt that God was laying this song on her heart, not just for Pune, but just that song on her heart for us as a fellowship. And so I think, I don't know about Bombay, but definitely Pune and Bangalore are doing House of Miracles. So really just
to share. So basically we started worship practice at 7:30.
Little louder, my God.
At 7:30 in the evening. And just as we started, we said we should start with House of Miracles. We played maybe two notes and then Pavs called
And she's like, Sandy, I'm having some trouble with the... And then so basically we worshiped together over the phone and we just grabbed through the whole song together. So it was, we got to do it together.
So I think really just that if we're not just singing the song, but we believe this is a house of miracles today. And just, you may need a miracle. And maybe it's a miracle that you're looking for, you've been praying for family, for friends, for the nation, whatever it may be that has been on your heart that you want to see a miracle. Not even just a breakthrough, a miracle. Let's really believe that that's what he's going to do today.
Full of faith. everything in the name of Jesus. This is a house of miracles. Come alive in the name of Jesus. Come alive in the name of Jesus. This is a house. Just look at him.
to him.
Bye.
bring this day into your hands. You are a home so secure. You are the perfect idea of love. You are the embodiment of everything good. You are so good to us. As your children, we ask for wisdom, for kindness. Teach us, Lord, teach us how to be your children. Teach us to follow, to serve, to love. I ask for your protection over every single one of us here. Your protection from our own selves at times, from any evil. I ask for your unending, abiding protection to just flow over us. Lord, we thank you. We thank you for this family, for this highway, for just being able to sing and talk about how good you are and to show how good you are as we spread out into our own lives, into our workspaces, into our schools, into every spaces outside highway. May we be able to be that embodiment of peace which you are, Lord. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.